Welcome to my secret place devotion with Oyiks, Alfred. The Word of God is alive and equipped to change your life.
Good morning and welcome to my secret place devotion. This is the second edition of our special edition, and we'll be looking at the five most important things that God has ever taught me. In the first edition, I told you that the first thing God ever taught me that is so important and has been the foundation of everything I've done in my life is that God is in control of every situation, every circumstance, every man, every satanic plan, whatever it is, whether it is the things that have been created already or the things about to be created, all of that, they all come under God. And so for me to thrive on earth and also to even thrive in eternity, what I need to concentrate on is concentrate on God, because He is the beginning, He's the end, He's everything. It's like the person that is in charge of an entire house is the person you should focus on, because if you focus on other people that are living in a particular house but don't have any influence, then you won't really have your way in that home. So if you come into a house or come into an organization, who is the most important person in that place? If you can be friends with the head of that organization, then you are good to go in that organization. Nothing untoward will ever happen to you. That's the same way it works. So God said, if you can seek me and find me, concentrate on me, then you can be assured that everything about your life will go very well. So the question now is, if God is really in control of everything, why is it that the devil is running amok in the lives of men, causing sickness, causing disease, you know, causing death, doing whatever he likes in the life of people, even in the life of Christians? The answer to that is the second most important thing that God has ever taught me. What did God teach me about the devil? Well, the truth is, I wanted to sound exactly like Jesus, how he sounded in John chapter 14, verse 30. I read it from the New Living Translation. It says, I don't have much time to talk to you because the ruler of this world approaches and he has no power over me. I wanted to sound like Jesus, but I saw that looking at the lives of people, you see that this is not their situation. You know, the devil has all sorts of things going on in their lives: sickness, death, disease, poverty, stagnation, whatever you call it, just name it, the devil is doing that in their lives. But how come this wasn't affecting Jesus? And I knew that I wanted to sound like Jesus. And so God taught me a very important lesson. He said, the devil needs to be empowered to function. If you do not give the devil power, he can't function. He's a very weak being. So for him to thrive in the life of an individual, there must be power that is given to the enemy to function. That is why the Bible tells us in Colossians chapter 2, verse 15, I read it from the New Living Translation. It says, in this way, Jesus disarmed the spiritual rulers and authorities. He shamed them publicly by his victory over them on the cross. Now, what this means is that Satan had ammunition, Satan had arms, Satan had the things he uses to harass and destroy people. But on the cross, Jesus took away his ammunition. So whenever you see the devil doing anything in this world, it means that somebody has given the devil back the ammunition that Jesus took away from him. And that is how the devil is able to do whatever he's doing. The devil always must be empowered to walk. If you see sickness, if you see disease, if you see death, if you see whatever it is that the devil is doing, just understand that somebody somewhere has given him power and has given him the right and the authority to do exactly that. So the question is, how exactly do people empower the devil to function in their lives? Remember, the Bible says to us in John chapter 10, verse 10, it said, the thief comes but to steal, to kill, and to destroy. Whenever you see your joy stolen, your money stolen, your marriage stolen, your health stolen, the devil. Whenever you see death and destruction, the devil. But like I said, he has to be empowered. So how do we empower the devil? There are key ways that we empower the devil without knowing. The first way we empower the devil to thrive is through sin. The Bible is very clear in 1 John 5:18. Again, I'm going to read it from New Living Translation. That is 1 John 5:18. It says, we know that God's children do not make a practice of sinning, for God's Son holds them securely, and the evil one cannot touch them. I'm going to read it again for emphasis, the last part. It said, and the evil one cannot touch them. Cannot is a very strong word. How come the evil one is able to touch people? How come the evil one is able to touch Christians? It is because we empower the devil through sin. Every time you sin, it's an open invitation to the devil to harass your life and destiny. So if you want rats to be somewhere, if you want rodents and rats and roaches and all of that to fill a house, all you need to do is just make sure the place is dirty. The moment the place is filthy, it is going to naturally attract rodents. It will naturally attract creeping crawlies and all of that. That's the same way. If your life is full of sin, you will attract the powers of darkness. That is how we empower the devil. Now, it's very important for me to read a particular verse of scripture in John chapter 5, verse 14. The Bible says, "But afterwards, Jesus found him in the temple and told him, 'Now you are well, so stop sinning or something even worse may happen to you.'" So imagine what Jesus is saying is that sin will allow something that has left your life to come back, but in a worse situation. So the question is, who is this man that Jesus is saying that something worse will happen to him? And Jesus is identifying that the thing that caused whatever to happen to the man is because of sin. That's why he said, stop sinning or something worse will happen to you, meaning that whatever is going on in his life is caused by sin. If you read the verses before, if you read that same scripture at the beginning of that verse of John chapter 5, let's read from verse 5 and 6. Remember, I just read verse 14 where Jesus says, stop sinning or something will happen to you. But if you read 5 and 6, it says, one of the men lying there had been sick for 38 years. This is the man Jesus was talking about. So meaning that the man was kept paralyzed for 38 years because of sin. So when Jesus approached him, Jesus healed him and said, you know what, if you continue sinning, what will happen to you? That something worse will happen to you. And that is the situation of many people. This man invited sin into his life for 38 years, and that's how come sin kept him crippled. And that's why a lot of people have been crippled in their finance, in their marriage, in one area or the other, simply because of sin. The second way we empower the devil is through bitterness, unforgiveness, and anger. Now, all sin is sin, but this one has a special key into hell. It unleashes the horrors of hell. It is bitterness. When you see unforgiveness, when you see anger, guess what? The devil is going to come there. The Bible says in Ephesians 4:26, it says, and don't sin by letting anger control you. Don't let the sun go down while you are still angry, because anger gives the enemy a foothold. So whenever you see bitterness, anger, what it means that you are allowing the enemy to come, you are empowering Satan. So that's why you need to let go. No wonder in Acts chapter 8 verse 22, Apostle Peter was talking to a man who thought he could buy the gifts of God with money. And he said to him in verse 22 of Acts 8, he said, repent of your wickedness and pray to the Lord. Perhaps he will forgive your evil thoughts. For I see that you are full of bitterness, jealousy, and you are held captive by sin. So why the devil was able to have access to the life of this man is simply because, you know, his heart had been filled with jealousy, with envy, with bitterness, and all of that, and he opened the door for the devil. Now, another way we invite or we empower Satan is through ignorance. If you do not know your right, you empower the devil. The devil thrives basically in our lives through ignorance. And so God taught me, fill your life with the knowledge of the word of God. In fact, how I stepped into functioning in the tremendous dimension of the healing anointing is Jesus teaching me this. He taught me about having power and authority over the devil. And he said to me one day, he said, so how about if you were the boss of your company and you just decide that this is your staff, you want the staff out of the company, and you write a letter to the staff to tell him to go, would the staff go or stay? I said the staff would go. Why? I said, well, because I have authority over the staff. He said, exactly. So that means whatever you tell the staff to do, the staff will do, because you have authority. He said the same way, you have authority over the devil. Whatever you tell him to do, he will do. But if you do not know your right, if you are ignorant, you will empower the devil to function. So the Bible tells us in Luke chapter 9 verse 1, he said, then he called his 12 disciples together and gave them power and authority over all devils and to cure diseases. So we are empowered. But if you are ignorant, you will not be able to have power over the enemy. Another way that we empower the devil is through invitation. We invite the enemy to have power in our lives and in our destinies by invitation. But some of us are inviting the devil knowingly. There are people that are involved in occultism, they're involved in witchcraft and all of that. They invite the devil knowingly. But there's this other group that actually invites the devil, but they don't know that's what they are doing. they empower the devil. I'll give you an example. People who listen to worldly music, they think they're enjoying themselves, but they don't realize that one of the vehicles of spiritual transportation is music. So music brings the Holy Spirit, and also music brings demonic spirits. The Bible tells us in 2 Kings chapter 3, verse 15, it says, "Now bring me somebody who can play the harp." While the harp was being played, the power of God, it came upon Elisha. Now, music attracts spirits, whether they are godly spirits or demonic spirits. So when you listen to all the music, you are inviting the enemy to have power. And a lot of times, people open up themselves to demonic powers and begins to cause sickness, disease, stagnation, all kinds of things in their lives. Not because the devil has power, but because they have empowered him to do whatever he's doing. And that's one of the most important lessons that God taught me. So how do you invite God? If you know how to invite the devil, how do you invite God into your life? Number one, invitation. By prayer, you invite God. Number two, knowledge. If you know about God, you know, you actually empower God to function in your life. If you know the ways of God, you empower God to function in your life. Number three is obedience. If you want your life to go well, obey God, you see God in your life. And then keep yourself pure, you will see God in your life. This is the second most important thing that he taught me. That is how to be able to sound like Jesus and say, "The wicked one has no power over me." Hope you have been blessed. Look out for tomorrow. We're going to take the third edition of this special edition of my Secret Place Devotion. God bless you.
For other life-changing messages, you can now download the app Rev Oyiks Speaks from Play Store for Android phone users or Apple Store for iOS users. You can also follow us on Instagram, YouTube, and Telegram, all on the handle Oyiks Alfred.